Harpa Audio presents How Dare the Sunrise, Memoirs of a War Child by Sandra Uwiringiyimana with Abigail Pesta. This is Sandra Uwiringiyimana. This book is for you, Mom and Dad, to you, Deborah, and to the 165 angels. Iki gitabo ngituye mama na papa. Ngituye Deborah n'abazira karengane 165. Chapter 1. The night began softly. My little sister, Deborah, and I were lying in bed, closing our eyes, trying to fall asleep in the midsummer heat. It was a couple of hours past dark, a scorcher of an August evening in Africa. I could hear the soothing voices of my mother and aunt chatting outdoors in the still heavy air. Deborah was 6 years old at the time, and I had just turned 10. For some reason, Deborah had been highly sentimental that day, hugging my mother and me, telling us she loved us. She did it time and again. I wondered what had come over her. Perhaps, somehow, she sensed that she would soon be leaving us. Sleep did not come that night. My mother stormed in from outside, a look of panic on her face like I had never seen. Mom was always such a calm, wise presence, strong and rarely rattled. At the time, we were living as refugees, driven from our home in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, because we belonged to a minority tribe, the Banyamulenge. For the past 3 months, I had been sleeping on a mattress on the ground in a big green tent at a crowded refugee camp in Burundi, run by the refugee arm of the United Nations. I shared my mattress with my mom and Deborah, the youngest of my 6 sisters and brothers. Mom and my sister Princess lived in our tent too. My dad and my brothers, Alex and Heritage, stayed in a tent next to ours. My sister Adele and brother Chris were with my grandparents up high in the Congolese mountains, known as the Ho Plateau. We were scattered, an unsettling feeling in such an uncertain time. For weeks, I had been dreaming of home, our big yellow brick house with a grass-green roof, filled with cousins and friends. I longed for the sparkling blue waters of Lake Tanganyika, the colossal lake where I loved to swim despite my parents' warnings about crocodiles. In the refugee camp, I had been imagining a time when I could return to school. I was an ace student, and I wanted desperately to put on my school uniform, navy blue knee-length skirt, white button-down polo shirt, white socks, and get back to class. I thought surely we would be going home soon, and my family would all be together again. That was wishful thinking. Mom shook Deborah and me from the mattress where we slept. Princess was away for the night, attending a choir concert in a nearby city.
Mujuke kwateu, Mom said. Wake up! We are under attack!
We shared our tent with 6 families, mostly women and children. We knew one another intimately, like family. When people heard my mom's warning, they said, "No, you must be wrong. You're overreacting." Perhaps some thieves were stealing livestock from the nearby farm, they said, explaining away the distant sound of gunshots. "No," my mother said. And then we saw my aunt, Nyarukund. She had been hit by gunfire while standing outside the tent. Both of her arms had been struck, and one had nearly been ripped from the socket. That arm dangled oddly from her body, dark blood gushing like a river. "We need to wrap her arm," Mom said. "Help me find something to wrap it with." I was surprised that my mother knew what to do in such a situation. It would have made sense to use my bed sheet. I had seen enough action films with my brothers to know that sheets were the go-to item in that situation. But I couldn't think. I couldn't see well either, as the tent was dark as night. I opened my suitcase and grabbed a favorite silky blue dress that made me feel like a princess. The dress was brand new, the most important and beautiful thing I owned. I had been thinking of wearing it to church that Sunday, but I was afraid to get it dirty. Church was held outside in the middle of the camp, and we all sat on the ground. I thrust the dress at Mom. Now I wasn't worried about soiling it. I just wanted to help my aunt. But the material was too slippery to wrap her blood-soaked arm. My mother pulled off the inner layer of her traditional cotton dress and used that instead. We heard noise approaching rapidly as men descended on the camp by foot, gunshots piercing the night. The shots sounded like popping corn at first, then grew louder as they came near. The tent erupted in chaos. People began shouting directions.
"Cut a hole in the side of the tent," someone yelled. "We'll escape through there."
People started huddling together in a corner. Somebody stepped on my leg, sending a rush of pain through my body.
"Ow,"
I said, but nobody heard. Everyone was in a panic. Someone cut a hole in the tent, and a stream of people ran out, including one of my cousins, Jeanette. Those people were gunned down, one by one, as they fled into the night. "This isn't real," I thought. "There is no way this is happening. I must be having a terrible dream. Surely I will wake up and it will all go away." Mom grabbed my sister, my aunt, and me, along with two of my little cousins, Musore and Rusengo, who were 6 and 9 years old. Mom said to hide beneath a mattress, and so we covered ourselves with the bed, staying close together, tense and still, down low to the ground. My aunt was in agony. The mattress was thin, and I thought about how bullets can so easily penetrate mattresses. It didn't make sense to hide beneath bedding from men with guns, but where else were we to go? I wondered if my dad and brothers were safe. I heard our attackers singing and chanting. They were singing Christian songs. I had grown up singing some of those songs in church, and I wondered why murderers would be singing them. "Imana yawa tugabie," the men chanted. "God has given you to us." The men seemed to think they were on a mission from God to massacre us. They spoke in two languages from the region, Kirundi and Swahili. I spoke both languages, and their voices sounded familiar. Why were we being targeted by people who were praising God? Gunshots, screams, chanting. Nothing made sense. It didn't register that people were dying, that my cousin had been shot dead as she ran from the tent. We must have been under the mattress for half an hour, huddled in silence. I didn't cry. I thought Mom would somehow find a way to protect us, because that's what mothers do. I heard splashes hitting the tent all around us. I thought it was beginning to rain. The sound of rain was always loud in the tent, as the raindrops pelted the tarp like little torpedoes. Then I heard a distant roar. Fire. It sounded like it was burning through other tents. The chanting grew louder and closer. "God has given you to us. God has given you to us." Suddenly, there was a moment of stillness outside our tent. Maybe the men were leaving since it had started raining, I thought. There were just a few of us left in the tent, so perhaps they didn't care. They had killed everyone else. Maybe they were done. Then we noticed the sharp fumes of kerosene. It had not begun to rain after all. The tent had been doused in kerosene. We continued to hide, paralyzed, until we heard some men come to the entrance of the tent. "Is anyone still here?" they called. "We've come to rescue you." At first, we stayed quiet. And then I heard my mother say, "Have you really come to help us?" I had a panicked feeling. I didn't trust these men.
even if they did speak our language. I had seen a lot of Jean-Claude Van Damme movies with my brothers. I knew that if these men were bad guys, they were not going to tell us. Come outside, the men said. We will lead you to safety. My mother seemed to believe them. I guess she felt she had no alternative but to trust them. What else could she do? Our tent would soon be in flames. Follow me, she said. She carried Deborah on her back and gripped the hands of my two young cousins on either side. My aunt crawled along beside her, somehow still conscious, despite the loss of blood. I stayed a few steps behind, wary. I worried that Mom was being too trusting. It was pitch black. I extended my arms to feel my way through the narrow hallway of the tent. I held onto the thick logs that propped up the tent, telling myself that each log could bring me a step closer to freedom. The shadows of the men loomed in the doorway. I heard a voice in my head saying, "Don't go, stay back." But I needed to stick with my mother, even if I doubted the intentions of those men. I couldn't leave Mom. We had to stay together. Still, I remained a few feet back, as the hallway wasn't wide enough for all six of us. Mom came to a stop at the door of the tent. She stood there, waiting to be saved, as promised. I was finally close enough to see the faces of the men who said they would deliver us from this hell. Their eyes glowed in the fiery light, their backs to the flames. They looked young, perhaps in their 20s. I began to feel a sense of relief. Maybe they really would help us after all. They wore camouflage pants and hats, military-style clothes. I could see their shoulders bulging from their tank tops, shining with sweat. One of the men carried a giant roll of bullets, like you'd see in action movies. The other carried a machine gun. They looked at us. "Bashiriremo," one of them barked. "Shoot them!" Suddenly, I saw sparks, bright blasts of gunfire hitting my mother. They looked like fireworks. The bullets went into her belly, and she crumpled. She was still carrying my sister on her back. I turned around and ran inside the tent. I didn't want to leave my mom. Children are supposed to run toward their mothers for protection, not away from them. But I had seen the sparks. I knew I had to hide. With my arms stretched wide to feel my way through the hallway, careful not to run into the logs, I stumbled back to my mattress refuge. I kept seeing sparks fly in front of me. A future as an orphan flashed before my eyes. I prayed to God, "If you keep my parents alive, I will be good," I promised. At the same time, I knew my mother had just been gunned down. She must be dead. Deborah must be dead too. My little six-year-old sister, gone. That beautiful girl who brushed the sand from my skin after my secret swims in the lake, gone. I couldn't accept the thought of it. She and my mother could not leave me. They simply couldn't. I kept praying. I begged God to please let us all survive. "I'll never tell a lie," I said. "I'll always do what my mom tells me." Then I blacked out. I awoke when something hot hit my leg. A fiery piece of tent had fallen from above and burned through the mattress, scorching my skin. The tent was in flames. Everything was melting around me. I saw men stealing things from our suitcases, grabbing whatever they could. They didn't notice me. I felt like I was in a movie scene. A 10-year-old girl sitting in the center of the frame while war raged around her. The men left, and I called for my mother. I called and called in the dark. "Mom! Mom!" I knew my mom would never abandon me, but I knew what I had seen. The sparks that sent her to the ground,
The smoke began to choke me, and I needed to run. I managed to crash my way through the burning debris of the tent. I emerged in the decimated camp, standing for a moment, frozen. Limbs, bones, and bloody bodies lay everywhere.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.